smoke, smoke, smoke that cigarette. Puff, 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 and if you smoke yourself to death, tell St. Peter at the Golden Gate.
You're probably already feeling a strong, polarizing emotion just from this one shot. For some of you, you're feeling that craving inside, that yearning for a cigarette, even if you don't smoke anymore. For others of you, it's a feeling of disgust, a repulsion at something you despise. And I bet most of you can tell that I don't smoke based on how silly I look trying to light this.
Whether or not you're a smoker, you have to admit, the cigarette is a powerful icon. It's also an icon of duality.
Duality is a powerful element of storytelling, and it can give a character a richer and deeper presence in the narrative, even if they're a minor character with limited screen time. For those of you new to the term, duality refers to the dual nature that a character can exhibit, such as a character that is both wildly brilliant and yet absurd and bumbling. Or perhaps that character is a caped crusader, focusing on justice while exhibiting many qualities that mirror the criminals he pursues. Normally, duality is used to give further depth to the protagonist of the story, a good person with internal demons and temptations. But sometimes, a story chooses to do this for the antagonist as well. Today, we'll examine the film Thank You for Smoking, and see what can be done when duality is used wisely and elegantly. Nick Naylor, the film's would-be hero, is the spokesman for Big Tobacco. His job is to lobby for what many consider to be the worst campaign of the modern age, the defense of cigarettes. And believe it or not, Naylor is playing a literal dual role in the story as both the protagonist and antagonist.
See, but this is weird because normally the protagonist is a good person or someone that the audience can relate to immediately due to honorable intentions and actions. Naylor is neither of these things. The guy's a silver-tongued devil, a professional liar, with a job whose sole interest is to convince the other party that they're wrong. In fact, many times that's how he says he wins arguments, by convincing the other party that they're wrong even if he's not right. There shouldn't be anything we relate to there.
The thing is, he really is likable. He has this innate charm, and the audience can't help but root for him, even if that means violating their own moral code. This is the power of duality in a character. We don't want to like him, but we can't help ourselves. And just as Naylor's job is to sell everyone on the idea of cigarettes, the movie's job is to sell you on the idea of Naylor. And this is where we see another form of duality, the dual nature of the narrative.
See, this is what's smart about the movie. The movie constantly portrays Naylor next to characters that are less likable or less interesting, like BR or his ex-wife or even the senator. In contrast to these people, Naylor stands out as the more easily likable or approachable character. But that's hard to stomach because we shouldn't like Naylor. I mean, the guy doesn't really align with most of our own moral codes, right? So we should want to align ourselves with someone that has a better moral standing, someone that agrees or follows more closely with what we ourselves believe. Shouldn't we?
For example, here in the opening scenes, Naylor is self-described as the It Man, the guy who can get any woman to hook up with him, or convince anyone of anything, for that matter. If that were all that he was, we probably wouldn't connect with him. But then we're shown that he's a father, that he's recovering from a failed marriage, and that he's still somewhat low on the ladder of work. Suddenly, whether we want to or not, we're beginning to find common ground with this character. We'll continue to see him admit to his shortcomings, such as wishing to learn more from those with more authority, and we'll even see him showing great weakness in moments of danger. Actually, this is probably my favorite scene from this movie, so let's examine this part for a moment. Naylor is here to convince the original Marlboro man, Lorne Lutch, that he needs to take this suitcase of money, the underlying intention being that he'll keep his mouth shut about how Big Tobacco is abandoning him.
This part's actually kinda true. So Wayne McLaurin, one of the original Marlboro men, developed lung cancer. In fact, almost all of them did. And Wayne McLaurin decided that he was gonna speak out for anti-tobacco legislation. And Big Tobacco tried to pretend that he had never worked for them. Marlboro actually tried to distance themselves as much from him as possible. We don't have a lot of time for that. I just wanted to point out, this is actually kind of true. So, anywho.
Now, Naylor is reluctant to go into this scenario for many reasons. Some of it morality, and some of it is a kind of bad business decision. But he does so anyway. He can see that Lutch doesn't want the money. And so in a moment of genius, he rehearses with him exactly how he should stick it to Big Tobacco by going on television and showing all the money. As he runs through this demonstration, he's slowly leading Lutch to the decision to take the money for his family, mostly by showing him things that he knows Lutch can't refuse. So now we have several scenarios of duality here. Naylor doing his somewhat ugly job, yet still helping someone. Lutch being both a man of pride and yet a man willing to be bought. And the audience feeling both happiness for Lutch and his pseudo-reward, but also sad because he balked on his morals in the end. This level of duality in both character and narrative is rare for a film, mostly because it can quickly become messy. Characters can only be so layered before they become muddy. And admittedly, this movie isn't perfect.
I particularly don't care for the rising action of the story, where Naylor is revealed to have told all of his dark secrets to the Washington Post reporter played by Katie Holmes. It's just uninteresting and weak storytelling because Nick's character has never been one of unabashed hubris. He's never been someone to just spill the beans at leisure. His job, as BR points out later, is to not say stupid stuff like that. So it's really flying in the face of that.
This fall from grace isn't satisfying, mainly because the downfall isn't a direct reflection of Naylor's nature, but rather a few actions and inactions on his part. Had the story revolved around his kidnapping and subsequent nicotine overdose, we might have truly felt real sympathy for Naylor, having lost his way because of the very cigarettes he fights for. Instead, we're stuck with the dark night of the soul coming from a massive amount of hubris, something that the character has never really shown before this outcome. Naylor may be brash at times, but he's never painted as naive or dumb. To have him destroy everything he's worked for by being absurdly foolish feels cheap and short-sighted. Regardless of this less strong narrative direction, we can still appreciate the character of Naylor, watching him struggle to be a good father while also struggling to be the it man for a company that doesn't really respect him. In fact, in almost every scene, the audience can find something to like in Naylor's actions, even if he's doing something despicable. And this is what makes him the antagonist and protagonist all in one. He constantly struggles against himself. He's his own worst enemy, and that really is the magic of duality. In a way, it's just like the effects of smoking.
The thing that makes you feel so good is also killing you slowly at the same time. That's a hell of a duality.
Ugh, sucks.
Some people say I'm a no count. Others say I'm no
good. Hey, thank you so very much for tuning in for another episode. We really, really enjoy making these, and we love talking about storytelling and love telling stories. If you like this and feel like doing it, please share it. Subscribe to catch more of our episodes coming out. If you didn't like it, leave a comment down below. Let us know what you'd like to see more of. Tell us what you don't like about the format. Hey, we're always up for changing. Thank you so much. We've got social links down below. Jake's are on the right. Mine are on the left. Our Tumblr page is down below. We have a Tumblr page. Jeez, we're moving up in the world. We're getting all fancy on you. So thanks so much for watching. We really appreciate it. Take care. We'll see you soon.